بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. In this lecture today, we are going to present the second part of the object detection algorithms, which is about region proposed networks. So in the previous lecture, we have presented the object detection operations that are used for the YOLO algorithm. And today we are going to discuss other kind of techniques that are based on proposing particular region of interest into an image and then passing this region through a convolution neural network for the classification and also the identification of the bounding box. So let's start with a reminder as we used to do. In the previous lecture, we talked about the concepts of object detection and we clarified the difference between image classification with localization, and image detection. So image classification with localization, it means classifying the image and also localize the object inside the image. And in order to localize the object, we need to identify a bounding box with its coordinate and the width and the height. And a more general concept is the object detection, where you have to identify not only one object in the image, but several objects. And for this, you need to have several classes and also several bounding boxes that must be identified into the image. So this was the model that we have used for the object classification and localization. If we want to localize and classify an object in an image, so we need, first of all, to specify its position in the image. And this is specified by the coordinate of the center of the bounding box, okay, bx and by. And also the width and the height of the bounding box. And all this information, okay, will make part of the output. So before, our output was only having the name of the classes, cat, dog, and bird, for example. But now it will have another probability, that is the probability that there is an object in the image, and also the coordinate of the bounding box, and also the name of the classes. Okay, so this is the reference model for object classification and localization. And then also we have talked about how to turn a fully connected layer into a convolutional layer using one-by-one convolution. And this is actually a basic building block in YOLO detection algorithm, which allows actually to pass the whole image only once to the classifier. And finally, it will not only return the name of the classes, but also the different object and their bounding boxes. Okay, this was thanks to the technique of turning the fully connected layers into a convolution layer. And mathematically, it will result in the same dimension of the vectors. Yes. Okay. Like this is fine. Okay, we have also talked about the non-max suppression. And here, usually at the output of the detection algorithm, we can have several overlapping bounding boxes. So we need to remove all of them except one. And there is an algorithm that is the non-max suppression that try to keep only the one that has the largest prediction probability and has an IOU greater than 0.5. Okay, if the bounding box satisfies this criteria, it will be kept. And all other overlapping bounding boxes, they will be removed from the detection output. Okay, so here you can see the impact of deep learning on the accuracy of object detection algorithm. Just to remind that before 2012, before the era of convolutional neural network, the mean average precision, okay, over large data sets was actually at the boundary of 40%. And after 2012, with the use of deep convolutional neural network, we were able to reach up to 80% of mean average precision on very large data sets. So this shows actually the impact of convolution on increasing the mean average precision for object detection algorithms. And today also we are going to see for the region proposal algorithms how the convolution has contributed to improve not only the mean average precision, but also the speed of the object detection algorithms. So these are the learning outcomes for today. First, you will understand how to extract regions from an image, because in the previous lecture, we didn't actually talked about this, but actually we pass the whole image into a convolutional neural network into a grid. So the regions were actually represented as the grid that is used by the convolutional neural network. But here we are going to try to extract particular regions that will be later on fed to the convolutional neural network for the classification. So there are several techniques that we will present on how to extract regions. And also we will recognize the concept of selective search, which is an algorithm for extracting regions. And you will understand the RCNN object detector, which is the region-based convolutional neural network for object detection. And also you will learn about the two other improvements, that is the fast and faster RCNN improvement. And nowadays, currently, faster RCNN is actually used. We don't use any more RCNN or fast RCNN, because faster RCNN, which is it implements all the concepts of RCNN, but it has new features that makes it much faster. And this is why it is called faster RCNN. So first of all, we need to understand the concept of region proposals and how this is achieved. Of course, in the previous lecture, we have talked about the concept of a sliding window. And this means we are going to take a part of the image into a window, and then we will keep sliding the window horizontally and then vertically until we cover the entire image. And we have said that this process is slow and not effective. And also, the objects in the image do not have necessarily a square shape, and also they might have different sizes. So one of the things that was done is to try a sliding window with different sizes, with different width and height. But still, if you have to do this for the whole image, it's going to take a long time and it's not efficient. So let's consider, for example, in this image, and you want to develop an object detector to detect cows. Okay, so if you are going to make sliding windows over all the parts of the image, okay, from left to right and top to down, this is going to take a long time. And look, all these parts here, for example, this part and this part and this part does not have images. So it's kind of, it will be useful if we can find a technique that will try to identify as and differentiate between the background and the foreground. Try to put in highlight the objects, okay, that are likely to be present into an image, to focus the sliding window on these objects instead of spending time in searching the whole image, okay, without a big efficiency. So this is the idea of region proposal. We try to propose a region that will reduce the search space. And as such, we will save time, okay, and we will be able to have higher accuracy and also faster execution times. Okay, so this is the basic idea of selecting only the regions where object can be found. So for doing so, there has been a lot of techniques that were proposed in the literature. Okay, one of the first techniques is the SIFT feature matching. But SIFT here, it tried to find similar features into two images. So for example, this is one image here in the right side and another image in the left side. So SIFT feature matching, it tried to match features or areas in the image that are similar. It does kind of clustering to identify a region of the image with several with similar characteristics and try to match them. But it doesn't help too much in what concerns selecting the region for into an image. This is another technique that is called the multi-scale saliency. Okay, and it is based on fast Fourier transform. So in this technique, we can actually apply fast Fourier transform at different scales in order to identify possible regions or of images. Okay, for example, if we apply at this scale, okay, we take the image A, where there is a giraffe here and an airplane. So in the first scale, it will be able to identify that this region here possibly contains an object. So in this case, I can consider this place as the search space, where I have to look for object, and this space here is just the background. Okay, but also going to another scale, okay, it's possible also to identify smaller object like this area here. It's likely that it corresponds to some object, which is the airplane in the real image. So this kind of technique, it allows to reduce the search space and focus on the areas where the object may be located. Okay, you can see also in the second image here. Okay, but the problem, for example, if you see in the image here, applying at different scales, it's not able to detect these small scars over here. Okay, so it's not really very efficient for high precision object detections. So another possible way also is to consider the color contrasting to an image. Okay, and in this case, we can try to focus on areas that have similar color contrast and group them. We can do kind of clustering, or this is what we call also image segmentation taqseem. Taqseem ila manataq mutashabah. Okay, so you can see there is a color contrast مثلاً, between this sheep here and the grassland. There is a color contrast between this train that appears in the image and also the surrounding, and also between this pigeon and the sky here. But this technique might not be very efficient if we only rely on the color, because there are some other parameters and factors that may also impact and affect the regions and spaces into an image. For example, the level of lighting, the darkness, and some other factors as well. Okay, also some other techniques have focused on trying to identify edges through the edges density or edges detection. Like in this image, for example, you can see we have a bus. So if we make edges detection, okay, we can make the edge detection for this image. So we can have an image like this with only the edges. And we can look at the locations where there is more density about the edges. And we can think that, okay, maybe this area would contain an object and we will focus the source space in this area. Okay, so here also we can apply it, for example, to identify this part of the plane or the building and so on, big things. But it might not be very robust. If we now look at the image see here, okay, we can see that there is a high density of edges, but doesn't correspond to any object. It corresponds mainly to the sea, which is the background. And okay, maybe we can identify also these different قوارب هذا الاثنين اللي هنا. Okay, so edge detection, it's a possible technique, but it's not very robust for high accuracy object detection algorithms. So more recent techniques, which were proven to be more effective, it's called superpixel straddling or the selective search. It is actually based on the concept of segmentation of the image. Okay, the image segmentation. What does it mean, image segmentation? So in very simple words, it tried to cluster the pixels that are similar to each other. And in this case, it can try to identify regions. Okay, so these are the real images here. And this is a first level of segmentation. And then actually we can merge. We can merge the area that are similar to each other until finally we can have some high level details like this. So look at the numbers here. Now, if you look at the numbers here, I think you can identify some regions. Look here, there are some numbers that are between 0 and 10, 0, 1, 5, 4, 10, 4, 3 here. Some numbers, 124, 127, 135, close to each other, you see. And here some numbers that are 255, 240, 235. So if you look at this image, you can think that we can decompose, although these pixels have different colors, but we can group them into specific clusters, okay? And this is what we call the segmentation. So we can have something like this. So it makes sense. Okay, so in this case, we can make clustering techniques to group these pixels that are similar to each other. And we can have a first level of clustering, which will identify regions. And then we can analyze these different regions and, okay, maybe this part here will correspond to an object, or this part here will correspond to an object. So we can focus the search. Okay, maybe this one corresponds to an object, so I can feed this window into a classifier, or this window into a classifier, and so on. So it will help to guide you the search for possible objects into the image. And what selective search also do, because it makes kind of hierarchical clustering or segmentation. So we can see that, for example, at the second step, we can see that pixels here that are 112 and 231, 255 are similar to each other, close to each other. So we can group them into one region as well. Okay, and so on. So you can see we can have, in the beginning, fine grain segmentation of the image space. And then every time we're going to iterate and merge the different segments. For example, here, this segment here and segment here corresponds to the sky. So let's put them into one color. Okay, and this place here maybe corresponds to a building. So we put them into one color. So we try to identify similar regions, and then we group them into one cluster. So the selective search design consideration are presented in this slide, and you can go back to the paper. It's called Selective Search for Object Recognition. And this is the link to the paper. You can find it also on the LMS. And it has three design considerations from the authors. First of all, it must capture all the scales. The object can occur at any scale within the image. And this is why we have kind of hierarchical clustering. Okay, some objects have less clear boundaries than other objects. Therefore, in selective search, all object scales have to be taken into account. This is most naturally achieved by using a hierarchical algorithm. So if I come back here, okay, we're going to make the segmentation into hierarchies. We start by very fine grain, and then we will make coarse grain segmentation of the image. So here we will be able to identify bigger object. And in this kind of segmentation, we will be able to identify smaller object. For example, this one could be considered as a sheep object here. But if we go at this scale, we might not be able to identify it because it is merged all together. All these are merged together. But we are able to identify that there is a person here. Okay, so this is now the concept of capturing all the different scales, and this is used through a hierarchical search algorithm. The second design consideration is the diversification. It means there is no single optimal strategy to group regions together. So what does it mean? So if you remember, I talked to you about color contrast, and I said that the color contrast is not the only criteria to identify a region, because we can have lighting conditions such as shading, and the color of the light may influence how region form an object. Okay, so in their paper, instead of considering a single strategy, either on color or lighting and so on, they have merged all together. Okay, so that they have a diverse set of strategies to deal with all cases. Now, there is an algorithm that is made in several steps. I'm going to introduce that. So here, there is nothing related to learning. Okay, we don't have a learning here, but there is an algorithm that is going to make the identification of the regions. I will present just in a while. And you have, and the third consideration is it must be fast to compute. Okay, and this is why the selective search was on the top of the strategies that were considered as a candidate for being used in convolutional neural network with RCNN, as we will see later, because there are several other strategies for selecting the region or for the region proposals, but most of them are not fast. But of course, we will see that also selective search is not as fast as it is needed for CNN, but as compared to other approaches, it is considered as fast. And the goal of the selective search is to yield a set of possible object locations for use in practical object recognition framework. So this was the objective. We want just to focus on possible object into an image to feed them into an object recognition framework. The creation of this set should not become a computational bottleneck. So the algorithm has to be fast. So for the implementation of the diversification strategy, they have used the concept of similarity between the different pixels or the regions to merge them. And the similarity is computed based on the different attributes to take into account, diverse property responsible for the region of an image. So for example, they have considered the light intensity, the shading, the size, and different parameters. So to calculate the symmetry between two regions, region I and region G, okay, it is equal to a linear sum of the similarity of colors, similarity of textures, similarity of size, and similarity of the fill, Okay, so this is a linear combination of both. It calculates, and based on the value calculated by the similarity, they will decide the similarity between two regions. And now we come to the hierarchical grouping algorithm, which is the following. It's the same algorithm taken from the paper, which is a greedy search algorithm to find the region of the proposals. And the procedures used obtain initial regions by segmentation. Okay, segmentation, first of all, we make fine-grained segmentation of the regions, and then calculate the similarity of the neighbor regions, and finally, grouping the similar regions to the same bucket, put them into the same group, or they will become the same region. Okay, coming to the most similar region with the same bucket, and repeat the steps. Okay, so here this is the technical algorithm about the hierarchical grouping algorithm. So as you can see in this table, there has been several region proposal techniques that were proposed. So you can see here the performance in terms of time, repeatability, recall, and detection MAP. So this is the selective search. It has a high MAP, 31.7 and 32.3. Here 31.8, 32.2. And it is, along with edge boxes, it's another technique also, they have the smallest time. Okay, so they have the best trade-off or good trade-off between time and accuracy. There are also other techniques, but those two techniques actually stood up for as a candidate for convolutional neural network and object detections. So here you can find also additional summary of related works regarding the sliding window approaches. Okay, having understood how selective work or how selective search works, now we can start talking about RCNN, which basically is going to use selective search to identify regions, okay, into the image, and then it will crop these regions. So it will make region proposals, 2,000 region proposals, and then we'll feed them into a classifier. And the classifier at the end is going to classify the regions, telling whether there is an airplane or person or any other classes. Okay, so the selective search will just be able to extract possible objects from the image, and then we will apply the classical object classification or object classification and localization algorithm that we did before, applied to the different crops from the image. Yes. No, it will take the cropped images one by one. Okay, it will take the cropped images one by one. Okay, so how does RCNN work? It's pretty much simple as a concept. So first of all, you take an image, okay, and then you will apply a proposal method. Okay, proposal method like the here it will apply selective search. And this will generate about 2K, it means 2,000 region proposals, which are bounding boxes for image classification. It will generate 2,000 bounding boxes for image classification. Okay, so it will take this one, this one, this one, this one, this one, this one. And then we'll feed all these 2,000 boxes into a classifier and detector. It will discard unlikely object locations, and it will try to keep only the detected objects. So each bounding box, okay, then for each bounding box, image classification is done through a CNN. And finally, each bounding box can be refined using regression. So here the regression, it's possible to be done. What does it mean, regression? We will use the object localization to fine-tune the location of the object. Maybe, for example, the cropped image is not optimal, so we can optimize the width and the height of the bounding box using a regression. Okay. That's the idea of RCNN. And you will see that the regression here, it's not mandatory, but it will help to improve the accuracy or the mean average precision of the detection algorithm. So as already mentioned, the RCNN starts with the selective search. It will try to find color, texture, region size, region filling similarities as non-object-based segmentation. Okay, so this will lead to a first level of segmentation like this. So it will convert an image like this into an image like this that contains several segmented regions. And then we apply the same algorithm iteratively, okay, to try to identify bigger regions. Okay, so finally we can see that here, this is possibly an object, this is possibly an object. So these different features map, or these different region, proposed regions, will help to guide how to identify the different bounding boxes. And it uses the bottom-up approach. Okay, it's used the small segmented area are merged together to form a larger segmented area, as you can see in this image. And about 2K region proposals will be generated as shown in the image. So it can generate, for example, these blue bounding boxes or green bounding boxes. But these blue bounding boxes, at the end, they will go through the classifier, and the classifier will check that there is no object, and it will return void. So we will keep only these correct predictions, as you can see here. So this is the process in detail, or the classification process. First of all, we are going to apply selective search. We will generate 2,000 bounding boxes, and we are going to feed these 2,000 bounding boxes into a convolution neural network. So in the beginning, they have tried to use AlexNet, and then they have tried to use VGGNet. Okay, so this is a normal classifier using AlexNet or VGGNet. And finally, it's going to return this feature map, which is 6 by 6 by 256 filters. So this is the size. It will be flattened into one dimensional vector like this of size 9216. Okay, and then we will have this feature vector here is going to go through a classifier, so two fully connected layers, and this classifier is going to provide you the class scores using a softmax function. Okay, and also it can go through a bounding box regression to provide you the coordinate x1, y1, x2, and y2. But this regression is not mandatory, it's optional. Why? Because here when you take the cropped image, okay, it contains already the whole image of interest. Okay, so we can just consider that the bounding box is at the same size of the image here. The center of the image is the coordinate, and the width and the height of the bounding box is the size of the cropped image. But it turns out that using a regression like this, it may help to improve the accuracy, as I'm going to present in a while. So this is now the basic workflow for the RCNN algorithm. Okay, at the output layer, it computes this. It computes the following output, and then it uses by default, or the original version, it uses a support vector machine, an SVM classifier, to tell about the class. And this actually led to have only 34% of mean averaged precision, MAP. It means mean average precision, which is a unit that we use to, let's say, to evaluate the accuracy of object detectors. And this value is actually low. So one improvement was actually try to use a softmax function, okay, and to train the classifier using a loss to improve the output here, the accuracy of the output. And this actually has led using it has led to an improvement of 10% more. So it has reached 54% of MAP just by changing the support vector machine by a convolution, by a fully connected layer and the softmax at the end for fine-tuning the log loss again. Okay, and fine-tuning here, it means we are going to retrain the whole convolution neural network based on the output in order to improve the classification accuracy. And this has resulted into a major improvement of 10%, from 44% to 54%. Another improvement that was also done is to consider the bounding box regression. And here it means we are going to tune. So it's true that we are going to get the bounding box coordinate from the cropped image, but we can actually improve the coordinate here to, for example, removing more backgrounds in the image and only focusing on the object, okay, through a learning process. And this has improved the MEP up to 58% with AlexNet. And the final improvement was to change AlexNet by VGGNet. And this has led to an MEP of 66% of MEP using VGGNet. So this is the maximum accuracy or mean average precision that was achieved with the RCNN algorithm using VGGNet and all these different improvements. So to summarize, the selective CNN based classification and scoring, it is based on, first of all, feature extraction using AlexNet or VGGNet that is used to extract the CNN features for each proposed regions. Okay, so of course, this is after proposing the regions using the selective search. So for this, we are going to input the proposed region into the AlexNet or VGGNet with 227 by 3. And composed of 5 convolution layer and 2 fully connected layers. This is the architecture of AlexNet. And finally, it computes a feature vector of 4096. Okay, at the end of the forward propagation, and the input will have a size. This is the input size to 27 here. Then it will go through a classifier. The classifier by default is SVM, but softmax can also be used to improve the accuracy and do the training. Backward propagation on the whole network. And finally, you can do a regression. Okay, you can do a regression to improve the prediction of the bounding boxes from the cropped images. So these are the results of RCNN when it was applied on the dataset VOC, Pascal VOC 2010. So this shows a comparison between RCNN and RCNN with bounding box regression, because bounding box regression is optional, as I mentioned. But as you can see here, it helps to improve the accuracy or the MAP from 50% to 53% when it was applied on VOC to 2010. Okay, these are some CNN results, bounding boxes detected on different images by CNN, RCNN. Of course, now, what is the drawback of RCNN from what you have observed? What is the drawback of RCNN? Why? May miss some objects in the mixture. Why do you think that this can happen? In contrast, it is generated 2000 region proposals, so maybe it's going to generate more region proposals than possible objects in the image. What do you think are the drawbacks of the RCNN? No, because at the end it's going to go through the classifier. So there are two main drawbacks of RCNN. First of all, it is time consuming. Imagine for every image, you need to generate 2000 region proposals that may contain object or may not contain object. And then you have to throw them through a CNN model. Every image has to go through a CNN model. Okay, this makes from RCNN really very, very, very time consuming. So for example, just to predict one image, it takes 53 seconds. So this is not real time. Okay, almost 1 minute to be able to predict one image. Because for every image, and depending on its size, it will has to go through a selective search, which is time consuming. So it's a bottleneck. It has to generate 2000 regions and then apply these 2000 regions, each one into a convolution neural network. Okay, so this makes it not real time. And another problem, it is hard to train as well. It has three models to train in total. First, it has the CNN model, which is the AlexNet or VGNet. It has an SVM classifier that has to be trained as well. And it has a bounding box regression model that has to be trained. So it is a challenge to train three models separately. And another issue is that the selective search is a fixed algorithm. Okay, there is no learning happening at this stage. So it may lead to the generation of bad candidate regions. Okay, because the selective search is not going to learn how to generate the regions. It's going to apply one algorithm. And this algorithm may generate some good regions and some bad regions as well. Okay, so it's not very efficient. But at that time, at 2013, 2014, RCNN made a breakthrough. Okay, but after that, there was a lot of evolutions and improvement of RCNN to make it faster and to make it more efficient. And again, the convolution operation played a big role into reducing all these different bottlenecks, but in different steps. So to summarize, the RCNN, its region-based convolutional neural network, is an object detection algorithm that first segments the image to find potential relevant bounding boxes, and then run the detection algorithm to find most probable object in those bounding boxes. So first of all, you start from an original image, as you can see in the left. Then you perform segmentation. You will identify pixel-wise classification of the image. Every pixel you will assign to a particular class here. And then you will try to identify different bounding boxes using the region proposal selective search. And finally, you apply non-max suppression to only keep the good candidate of bounding boxes. And of course, the original algorithm is computationally expensive, as already mentioned, and slow. And newer architectures that are fast RCNN and faster RCNN were proposed. So let's look at the first improvement of fast RCNN. It was around 2015. And here the authors tried to solve the drawback of RCNN by building a faster object detection algorithm. So what is the approach here? Instead of feeding the original image, okay, to the region proposal, it first, the image is actually fed into a convolutional neural network to reduce its dimensionality. So instead of trying to extract the regions from the original image, which has high resolution or big size, we first apply a convolution. And from the convolution, we are going to identify the region of interest using a technique that is called region of interest pooling layer. Okay, the region of interest pooling layer, it will actually take the input from the feature map, and then to try to identify the possible regions, and then it will apply the same philosophy as the RCNN, two fully connected layers, and one softmax for the classification, and another regression for finding the coordinate of the bounding box. Okay, so from the convolutional feature map, we identify the region of proposals. Okay, so the difference is that in RCNN, region of proposals are identified from the original image, from the input image. However, in fast RCNN, the region of proposals, they are identified into the feature map. And the feature map will have less data, and it will be faster to process the information on the feature map as compared to if it is processed on the initial input map or the initial input image. So here, and this is the new thing here, they have used what we call the region of interest pooling layer. And this is just a max pooling layer that will be able to identify, to reshape the different bounding boxes into a fixed size, because the fully connected layer will only accept a fixed size input. Okay, and here the bounding boxes that are identified into the feature map, they might have different scales and different scale ratios. I mean different width and height and different sizes. And this we cannot input directly into the fully connected layer. So what they did, they made a pooling layer here that is a max pooling. And it's a 7x7 max pooling that will actually reshape the bounding boxes of the regions identified into the feature map and feed them into the fully connected layer. and then it will go through the same process through softmax and for softmax function for classification and for regression for the bounding box detection. Okay, is it clear? So here from the paper here, the reason fast RCNN is faster than RCNN is because you don't have to feed 2,000 region proposals to the convolution neural network each time. Instead, the convolution operation is done only once. Okay, so you do only one convolution instead of 2,000 convolution. And this actually helps in reducing the time a lot. Look now, for example, if you compare, this is the training time. For RCNN, it required 48 hours to train. 84 hours to train. And faster RCNN, it required only 8.75 hours to train. Now, in terms of the prediction time, okay, here including region proposal and excluding region proposals. So in the blue color, including the region proposal, it took 49 seconds to predict one picture. And if we exclude the region proposal, it will take 45 seconds. So only 2 seconds for region proposals and 47 seconds for passing the 2,000 regions into the convolutional neural network. Okay, so this bottleneck was replaced by just putting the whole image in one time into the convolutional neural network and then applying the max pooling layer, region of interest max pooling layer here, to reshape the identified regions. Okay, so still we apply the selective search here to identify the regions and then pass them through the fully connected network. So looking at the faster RCNN for the prediction, it takes only 0.32 seconds, excluding the region proposal. Okay, and you can see that the region proposal still take 2 seconds. So here the problem becomes the region proposal is the bottleneck. Okay, so for passing from RCNN to fast RCNN, we have solved the bottleneck that was in passing 2,000 region proposals into the convolutional neural network. However, in faster RCNN, so we improved this a lot because if we exclude region proposal time, it will take only 0.32 seconds, which is great. But the problem, the whole algorithm, it includes both region proposal and also the prediction, which is this part. This is the convolution and this is region proposal here. So the region proposal takes 2 seconds. And this represents a bottleneck for the fast RCNN. Does this make sense to you until now? Wada? Okay. Okay, so now this was actually the idea for the improvement is how to avoid this region proposal time to make it really real time or near to real time. And this was actually the objective of the faster RCNN. Faster RCNN, and it is faster as it stands from the name. So what's the difference here? So the difference is that we are not going to rely on selective search for region proposals. So faster RCNN shares the same concept as fast RCNN in the sense that it's going to pass the image first to a convolution neural network to extract a feature map. So until this step, everything is the same. Now in fast RCNN, when we have the feature map, we are going to use selective search. But it turns out that this is actually not very efficient in terms of execution time. So the selective search was replaced by region proposal network. The region proposal network. And instead of using selective search algorithm on the feature map to identify the region proposal, a separate convolution neural network is used to predict the region proposals. And you can see again that convolution helps in actually reducing the execution time and also improving the accuracy. So the predicted region proposals are then reshaped using نفس الشيء. الآن الاختلاف فقط أنه we have a new region proposal network to identify possible regions. So it's going to learn these possible regions. And the same thing here is going to be the same. We will use the same max pooling on the feature map for the classification and bounding box regression. Okay, so what is the objective of the RPN network? RPN, it means region proposal network. It will just, it's a classifier that will tell whether an object whether a certain space in the image corresponds to an object or not an object. And of course, here is going to use several anchors. Okay, it will use anchors. And in every anchor, it will tell whether there is an object or not object. So it can be reduced, the RPN network can be reduced just to a binary classification, object or not object. So if it is object, we're going to take this cropped image and also put it into the classification as we do before. Okay, so the classifier network outputs the score for each of the classes that we want to classify the object into. So this is the definition of the RPN from the original paper. It says that an RPN is a fully convolutional network that simultaneously predicts object bounds here and objectness scores whether this region corresponds to an object or not. This is the meaning. And the RPN is trained end-to-end to generate high-quality region proposals, which are used by fast RCNN for detection. Okay, فكل اختلاف صار لهنا الآن. عوضا على selective search, we are going to use another neural network, separate neural network, just for the detection of selected regions. Okay, so this is the step-by-step algorithm here. First of all, we are going to use a convolutional neural network, okay, to generate a feature map here. And the output is fed into two fully connected networks, one classifier and one regression. So the classifier, it will tell about the class, it will use a softmax function, and the regression is going to tell about the bounding box coordinates. So here we will have also, like we do in YOLO, we will have different anchors, and every anchor is going to slide on the image here. Okay, so the red box corresponds to an anchor. Every anchor is associated with a scale and aspect ratio. Okay, so last time we have introduced why you use anchors. So for example, we can make anchors like this. Maybe this is for detecting a person. This one maybe is for detecting a car. So we can try to define different anchors depending on the shapes that we are going to detect in the image. So in the original paper, every anchor was associated with three aspect ratios and three scales. The aspect ratio is the ratio between the width and the height. We call this aspect ratio. And the scale, it's the size of the bounding box. So in total, we have 9 anchors, okay? And the 9 anchors has to be designed such that they will fit most of the object that has to be detected. If you don't choose your anchors in a proper manner, you may miss several objects in the image, okay? So the performance of the detection algorithm heavily depends on how you choose your anchors. And this is why there are some automated tools that will tell you the optimal ratios, aspect ratio and scales for the anchor for a particular data set. Okay, so the regression layer, which is this one, is going to output the coordinate of the bounding boxes. So here is going to output the coordinate maximum of 4k of k bounding boxes. And the classification layer will output the probability that each of the k bounding boxes contains an object or not. Okay? And this is the objective of the RPN. Okay, is to tell whether there is an object or not. Okay, so and this is the role of the classification layer for every bounding box is going to tell whether there is an object or not. Okay, and then when it detects that there is an object, it will go through the classifier. Okay, it will go through the classifier in order to find, in order to tell about the class of the detected object. Okay, so this is an overview about RCNN, faster RCNN, and faster RCNN. I have just provided a superficial overview. Of course, there are a lot of details. Maybe we don't have all the time to go through all of them, but I'm going to give you some pointers if you want to read more about low-level details about how these different techniques are really implemented.